So we are doing our game as normal at 2:00. I will let you know when wrestling is over, and they will join us. And what we'll just do is just lay out during my count, and then you guys can be, hey, welcome, you know, welcome to College Lacrosse, blah, blah, blah. It's just a big reset kind of thing, okay? But we are calling it as normal because we will be on ESPN3.
So that open that we just put all that time and energy into won't even run live?
No, on the re-air, but on ESPN3 it will. Okay. Yep, is that Penn's coach that you see there on program? That's Doug Knight. Okay. Doug Knight. Headshot charts would.
Hey, Wayne, you're going to have to talk to
He's buried in there.
Okay, that's fine.
That's him. He's got a white shirt. 1 minute to air. Stand by.
You can use A2 if you want.
A2.
For yep.
To listen to
you? No, for stage two.
Okay.
All right. Guys, have fun. Have a good show.
Red, the open's on red, correct?
83 is the open.
There's Penn Coach. It's
Penn Coach. Kim, do you hear Becky?
Oh,
wrong time to be losing your voice there, partner.
Yep, that's
all right.
15.
Black on the line.
15 to air.
Stand by 83.
Everyone, have a good show.
9, 8, 7. Six.
Try not to fuck up.
Roll 83 up on 7.
St. Patrick's Day marks the start of conference play in the Ivy League. This afternoon, one of the best young middies in the game, Princeton's Tom Schreiber, faces a stingy Penn defense led by one of the nation's premier long poles in Will Koshansky. It's Princeton and Penn next on ESPNU.
The edge. The edge. Spitting you. Not a good thought, though.
Welcome to Old Spice College Lacrosse. We're on the campus of Princeton University, the class of 1952 stadium. The Princeton Tigers taking on the Penn Quakers, and it's the start of Ivy League play. Alongside the former Tewatin Trophy winner, Matt Ward, Ivanese Schroff, and Matt, first Ivy League game for both these teams. What does conference play mean to these guys?
Yeah, both these programs have played tough schedules thus far this season, but today is the real start to their season. There's something about that first Ivy League game that will get your energy going as a player. I bet if you ask Coach Murphy and Coach Bates, their number one objective this season is to win the Ivy League championship.
There's also a game within the game. Let's take a look at the edge. We're going to see a terrific one-on-one matchup this afternoon.
Yeah, for Princeton, Tommy Schreiber, in my opinion, the best middie in the conference. He can do it all. He can dodge from up top. He's very good off ball. And I think you see that he has 11 assists. That just shows how well he sees the field and sets him apart. He's going to have his hands full, though. Will Koshansky of Penn is a Major League Lacrosse draft pick of the Boston Cannons. He's a great athlete. He also has a great stick. You can see that he has 5 caused turnovers and 8 ground balls. That's going to be a fun matchup to watch for 4 quarters today.
And we are about ready for face-off here at the Class of 1952 Stadium. Danny Feeney at the X for Penn, and it's the junior Bobby Lucas for Princeton. Ivy League season about to get started. And Princeton scoops up the draw. Into the attack box as the Tigers clear. This is a Princeton team that has dominated Penn at this very site. They haven't lost a home game to Penn since 1988, and now the ball in his cross is one we're going to be watching, number 22, Tommy Schreiber.
Yeah, for Princeton, I think Tommy Schreiber needs to come ready to play today. He's going to be the focal point of this Penn defense, but he needs to excel no matter how much pressure, how early they slide in. He is the engine that drives this train.
And a matchup that we talked about in the edge, 22 against 28. That's what we're seeing right now. Schreiber working on Koshansky. Tucker Shanley swings it behind the cage to Jeff Fricaro, coming off a 5-goal effort in Princeton's last game, a win against Villanova.
And Jeff Fricaro, And Vaccaro is an interesting story. He came to Princeton, played midfield initially, was facing off. But I really like what he's been able to do this season at the attack spot.
There's Mike Grossman. Guarded closely by Max Meyer. Watch Alex Capretta. He can shoot it from long range. Schreiber now. Had it knocked away. Vaccaro trying to retrieve along the end line. Stays in bounds. Long early possession here for Princeton. Capretta. Here's Schreiber. In the crease for Vaccaro. Shot.
And that play right there, you see Schreiber to Vaccaro, the two-headed monster of Princeton offense. And that's what I think Coach Bates really likes about Vaccaro at the attack spot, is that you can see on the left side of the screen here, Vaccaro really does a nice job moving off passes. And you can see here he gets it and ducks underneath. And that's something Princeton hasn't had the last couple seasons.
First time to play. Yeah, okay.
Freshman Mike McDonald, he's a lefty, number 26 in white. Princeton in the white and orange, Penn in the blue and red. Shanley, too high. Princeton there to back up, it's McDonald.
Tucker Shanley having a solid start to his season. Coach Bates said there's not a shot that he doesn't like.
Tucker.
If his hands are open, he's going to take it. You know, that's one of those moves that you'd like to see increase his shooting percentage a little bit. Not shoot the first shot, but shoot the best shot at all times on the offensive possession.
One thing Princeton will do, they'll get their shots, lead the Ivy in shots per game. Shanley had it poked away. Who's got the ground ball? Blonsky comes up with it for Penn.
Five viewers.
Here come the Quakers. Unsettled, really not their style now.
Yeah, I think you're going to see their strategy is going to be a little bit more deliberate. They want to win the time of possession battle, then they want to win the shot battle. I think at this point, for them, they just need to make sure that they don't have lazy turnovers and that they just play their game, which is more methodical than a lot of teams in Division I lacrosse.
Here's Tim Schwale, number three. They'll kind of use two quarterbacks on offense. It'll be Schwale behind the cage, quarterbacking as an attackman. We'll also see John Keneally, number 13, quarterback from the midfield.
Now,
and there is Keneally, number 13. And Mike Murphy just loves his game.
Can your cast Savage. When Penn has the ball, can he switch?
Up top,
to
Meyer, the long pull. Saved by Tyler Fiorito. I didn't see that one coming.
I have never really seen a long stick get a shot like that after a minute of possession.
In generally, a field set.
Generally, you take him off the field, but you know, give him credit. They got him open.
Replay
and
here,
while he doesn't finish the shot, it's quite a handle for a long stick here. Cutting down, left-handed, and nice save for Fiorito. But again, interesting philosophy, I'd say, for Penn on the offensive side there.
Especially on a side out. All right, the next side out.
Penn still has it.
I can still do
Brian Feeney coming way out.
Yeah, 1A will be the promo on the next side out.
And now Savage will work.
Who I went down there, I
goal line extended area.
13 blue. So 13 blue, 22 white.
You mentioned Keneally having a great start to his season, and I think it's been key for them is the fact that he's now getting the long stick, which allowed them to move Dan Savage to attack. So, you know, the thought was there, if Keneally couldn't handle the long stick on him, they'd have to move Dan Savage back to the midfield. But Keneally's done a nice job, and it's really been the catalyst for this offense so far. So it's been a great philosophical change for this Penn offense.
Keneally, nice pass inside to Belinsky. You can't get it. But there to back up is Schwale.
And that's when Belinsky's going to want to get back. You can't miss those opportunities against this Princeton defense that is so athletic, so well coached.
I'll pass.
The opportunities that presented yourself. So Belinsky needs to capitalize.
Matt, we talked about Tom Schreiber going up against Alex Koshansky of Penn. John Keneally, top middie for Penn. He's going to have his hands full with number three in white in John Cunningham.
John Cunningham was taken in the sixth round of the Major League Lacrosse Draft. To me, he's very underrated. I think he may, you know, we hear about Wiedemeyer and how good he is, but I think Cunningham may have more impact on these lacrosse games than Wiedemeyer has had so far this season.
Penn, as is their trademark, they're going to be patient here on offense. Just kind of working it around the perimeter of the attack box.
He's lying to
Anthony
me.
Anthony Adler. He'll pull up. Savage playing catch. Adler check by the short stick.
Stall warning.
He's a really good feeder. Stall warning in effect. So they got to keep it in the box. Ryan Parietti.
Adler, and the stall warning is called. He stepped out of the box. Adler did, so Princeton will get it.
Take red back, take red back.
That was kind of just a mental mistake by Adler there. You know, they do a nice job of spinning the ball, but you have to be focused. You have to be where you are on the field. And right there, you can see his left foot is outside the box, and a great call for the refs there.
Beautiful. Nice job.
Guys, you got to move back. Move.
Kip Orban now in the game for Princeton, part of that second midfield unit.
He's definitely someone to keep your eye on. You know, he is growing as the season goes along. He's only a freshman, but Coach Bates like to say, you know, we're almost midway through the season. You're no longer a freshman. You have to play like a sophomore, and he's gotten better every single game, and that's what you like to see. In my opinion, the toughest position to transition in college across is the midfield. And each game he's getting better.
What makes that transition so hard from high school to college at the midfield level?
I think it's the speed of the game and that you always have to be moving your feet. In the high school level, these kids are so good that they can kind of take plays off. The midfield position, you can never take a play off. And that's so difficult a transition that these kids have to make.
McDonald being bothered by Meyer behind the cage. Orban, there's the freshman. Ricaro behind. The stall warning in effect now on Princeton.
Can't believe I did two.
Look at that. That was foresight right there. The refs had to call it again. Both teams playing at a slower pace than the refs are comfortable with, so that's why they're going to call the stall, which essentially brings the defense closer to the offensive players and makes it more difficult to play offense.
Fricaro switches hands. Make that Himmler.
And so the way most teams will counter when the stall warning goes on, they'll bring the ball behind the cage because it really takes the box out of play, as you can see Princeton isolate from behind.
Couldn't do much there for Sonnenfeld, the big guy. Flag, so this is going to be against Princeton, and Penn will go on the man up.
Is that it on 85 there, Kevin?
And you can see the goaltender Feeney out of the cage. And simply is just going to get tripped up. To me, it looks like incidental contact. I'm not sure that kind of the phantom, you know, turf monster potentially that got Feeney there. But regardless, when that happens, then you know, the cross, the refs can throw the flag 99% of the time. If you make contact, someone falls down, regardless if he trips over his own feet or whatever it is, the flag's going to be thrown.
Man up opportunity for Penn. 1 minute on the EMO. Princeton, the best man down unit in the nation this season. They've only given up one extra man goal in 10 tries. Schwale lost sight of the ball for a moment. That one hit the official. Scooped up by Princeton, so that's another man down defense coming through for the Tigers.
30 seconds!
And Coach Murphy can't be too happy with what you just saw from his man-up unit. A little lackadaisical in their stick work, didn't move the ball crisply, and then they threw that skip pass way too early in the set. Generally, you like to get the defense moving and then find those skip lanes. There was just kind of a lackadaisical back-footed pass that lost them possession.
More than halfway through this
first quarter, still scoreless, and really, we haven't even seen a good shot on goal so far. Max Meyer put one on Tyler Fiorito, but that was a long stick and an easy save for Fiorito.
And both these teams, though, I don't think that's that out of character. I think they like to be strategic and find the matchup that makes sense. And generally what you see in college across now is attack the short stick D midi. As you can see, you know, that's just where your matchup advantage is, and they're trying to get the ball to number 33, Alex Capretta. And this is where you initiate, because you can get that advantage by being guarded by a short stick.
There's the freshman, McDonald. McDonald, nice swim move. His pass bounces now into the cross of Grossman.
And something to highlight here, McDonald, the attackman, is being guarded by a short stick, which enables UPenn to bring an extra long stick up to guard midi.
Grossman's shot is blocked. McDonald recovers. Feeney's got to get back in the cage. And Princeton couldn't quite capitalize. Now, uncorking one is Schreiber, but way too high.
Murphy here.
Mike Murphy, head coach for Penn, in his third season, got him into the postseason last year with an 8-6 record. At the end of the regular season, they lost in the first round to Notre Dame. For Carl, left-handed cradle.
turns, fires, scores.
Start with red. Okay. Replace here. Red, and then I like 85. It's going to be red to 85.
Just a nice job by Carl, isolating from behind. You can see number 10 here. Goes to his left hand on the jump shot. Not his strong hand. Just look at the skill that he has to bury that top shelf. I think what people who don't play lacrosse, the tough part about that shot is keeping it high. Generally, you're fading away, shooting a jump shot. You're going to pull the ball to the ground. And so that's what goalies are expecting, so they drop their stick. Caro has the ability to keep it top shelf, and that's why Feeney wasn't able to stop it.
Penn controls the draw.
That was Princeton
goal. Not been good at the faceoff X this season, but Mike Murphy telling us you have to give that a little context. Coming in, they were 34.6% under 35, but they played some of the better faceoff teams in their non-conference schedule early on.
And they're playing a freshman and sophomore at the X, so it's a huge learning curve at that position. They're going to get better, especially the way they like to play lacrosse. They have to get better. They need to control possessions because they don't go up and down the field. They have to control time of possession. For them, it's very key.
Second midfield line now in for the Penn Quakers. That's Machucky, Bach, and Lasco. Schwale behind the cage. He's number three in blue. There's Dan Savage. Savage, number 20 for Penn.
Right, because I'm trying to hold on the focus point.
And Savage actually started the year as a midfielder, played midfield last season, moved to the attack in the UNC game, and he's basically stayed there because he's really stabilized Mike Murphy's attack. Savage, got that little spin dodge, not there.
Yeah,
it's a very physical dodge, you can see there. He likes to use his body, and for them it's been key to success here lately in terms of their offense production.
Fitzpatrick.
Look at the battle.
On Myers, who wouldn't give an inch, and Fitzpatrick had it knocked away. The stall warning was in effect. And it will be finished the ball.
And just too much time with the ball on your stick there, Fitzpatrick, kind of doing what we'd like to call butt dodging, standing still, and it just sets yourself up to be double teamed. And that's what Princeton was able to do. And you can see here, he's just too long with possession in the stick of Fitzpatrick. And right here, Princeton sniffs it out and gets a great double team.
Yeah. 28, Jonathan Myers really standing his ground on defense.
Here. Layout. 3, 2, 1. Now, big welcome. We're back here. Big welcome.
Welcome to Old Spice College Lacrosse. We want to welcome those viewers watching wrestling on ESPNU. 1-0 Princeton here in the first quarter. Kip Orban. Princeton will play it behind the cage. Tigers getting their goal from
nice
Jeff Ficarro.
Yes,
with Matt Ward and East Schroff here at Clash of 1952 Stadium in beautiful Princeton, New Jersey on St. Patrick's Day. It's the Ivy League opener between these two. And it's been a first quarter largely dominated by long Princeton possessions.
Yeah, keep me updated on what he's doing there.
And right now, that's the matchup you want to keep your eye on. 22 in white, Tom Schreiber against 28 in blue, Alex Kashansky, the long stick for Penn.
And you can tell right now, Princeton's sticking to their guns. They know that Schreiber's got a nice long stick with Kashansky who could potentially lock him up. They're going to attack the short stick D-middies of this UPenn team to initiate their offense, to try to draw slides and make 1-2 pass for step-down shots.
Here's Orban. Ficarro, who's got one goal already, trying to pass in the middle. It goes awry, and Schreiber scoops it up. We have not seen the ball in Schreiber's cross a whole lot so far. Schreiber working on Kashansky. Great defense there by number 28.
You know, that was just a great matchup in general. Kashansky did a nice job keeping on his hands, but you can see Schreiber so strong and athletic that he could get his right hand free, and he got some heat on that shot. So it's gonna be a great one to watch all game long for sure.
There's Will Himmler. Now Grossman.
Yeah, sit on that. So we weren't on the air when they welcomed this?
Orban up top. Had it taken away by Kashansky. And a flag goes away. Flag comes up. Yeah, Will Kashansky is making his mark on this game. May have been a little too aggressive there.
That's just a tough position for any defensive player to be in. He was sliding to someone who was stepping down with a full head of steam to take a shot. He got his stick in there. He dislodged the ball. So I'm interested to see what the refs here. Is it going to be a hold, or did he get him in the head? And to me, that's a tough call for any defensive player, because what are you supposed to do? You got your stick into his arms, and you lifted the ball out. To me, that's good defense, and that's coming from a former attackman. I always used to laugh when that would happen to me and someone would strip me, but they'd call him with a hold. I'm sitting there saying, that's just a good check, in my opinion. So, you know, not that defense is difficult as it is, but that makes it even harder.
It's coming from an All-American attack. 1-0 Princeton, 1:35 to go with Matt Ward and Ace Schroffer in the first quarter.
Well, actually, the penalty
is on Princeton. It's on Himmler.
So that makes sense. I'm not sure exactly how he got a hold when it was off a pass, but we'll have to kind of come back to that one.
Penn will clear. Second opportunity. Well, I guess it looks like it's even strength here.
Gotcha.
So each guy.
Yeah, each guy got one.
Okay, that makes sense.
Well, each guy got one, so it doesn't matter. They.
And the reason you Penn then got the ball is because on the next Princeton's side out, came afterwards.
We got to do the edge
so
here.
The team that conducts the foul.
If there's the last first quarter,
it doesn't get possession.
I will take the music video bump that's already been
Penn here on offense.
215A.
1-0 game.
On 83, you said?
At Clash of 1952 Stadium. Ivy League opener for both these squads.
15 seconds.
Final minute here in the first.
Yes, but it looks like it's going to be.
Yeah, I think they're just kind of waiting for players to be released.
Looks like it's going to be the end of the quarter here before.
Oh, very nice. And Penn gets the back of the net.
Passes back.
And hold
number
three.
Tim Schwale.
On 83, yeah. Replace here, high end zone. 83.
And so this goal right here is going to be a man up goal, or basically happened when they were man up. And you can see Schwale just gets his hands free. A nice job by Penn making tic tac toe passes right on the stick side high. And Schwale there, that's the easy part. You know, stepping in from 5 yards with your hands uncontested, that's the easy part. But Penn moving the ball crisply created that goal in the man up situation.
Back to the face off X. Jeff Fraccaro now facing off for Princeton. He's an attackman going up against the freshman Joe McCallion. And it's Fraccaro who comes away with it.
Here.
I don't think I've ever seen a team that uses a face-off man who plays attack primarily. So that, I think, speaks volumes about how deep Fraccaro's game and skill level is.
Final 20 seconds, Koshansky on Schreiber. Princeton behind the cage. Yes. That was Capretta. Ball is tipped. The long pole. Cunningham fires. Saved by Feeney. And time will expire here in the first quarter. Pair of Ivy League rivals all tied up at one. Fraccaro the goal for Princeton. Schwale for Penn. 1-1 after one.
Go ahead. All right. I know that you guys, I was going to show you the holding of the stick, but once you guys said, I won't have to show you. So, unless you think differently, then I'm sorry. Gotcha. All right, next time I'll just show it to you, no matter what. All right, now we get the chance to do what we want to do here, now that we have a full audience. We are going to come back with billboards, then we're going to do score, and then we're going to do the edge again, guys, okay? All right. And just give an Old Spice mention on that score, Anish. So billboard, score, the edge. Everyone listen up. Here's our traffic coming back. It's going to be billboards, then score, then the edge, and then we'll be ready to play. All right? It's going to be 83. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, wide shot three, please. How much time?
How much back, Becky?
Old Spice College Lacrosse is brought to you by Old Spice Body Spray. Smell is power, and in part by Sector Spider ETFs. Visit them on the...
Billboards, score, the edge, playing.
No, I'll tell you when to get them out there.
Composite.
45 back. And then at some point, gentlemen, while we're playing, we'll get into focus points. All right. 30 back.
Stand by black.
What's the shot that we're coming out with here?
It's
we got a crowd shot or something? Or?
No, it'd be...
No, it'll be... it'll
face off?
Be off the scenic.
Okay.
Be off the scenic.
Okay.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Here's billboards.
Old Spice College Lacrosse is brought to you by Old Spice Body Spray. Smell is power, and in part by Sector Spider ETFs. Visit them on the web at sectorspiders.com.
Go, Anish.
And welcome back to beautiful Princeton, New Jersey. Start of the second quarter. Ivy League opener between Penn and Princeton. We've got a tie game, and let's revisit the edge. We identify this individual matchup, Will Kashansky for Penn against Tom Schreiber. First quarter, you got to say, advantage Kashansky. He held Schreiber in check.
Yeah, he's doing a nice job getting on Schreiber's hand, but I think there's a lot more to the story to be told. Schreiber is such a talented player, so keep your eye on that matchup.
Two of the best in the business as we get ready for the start of the second quarter. And again, the face-off won by Fracaro, the attackman. Why is it so rare to see an attackman face-off?
Especially, you know, the game of college lacrosse generally has gotten to the point of where you're a face-off, get-off guy, where you just specialize
Fogo.
On playing. What we like to call the Fogo, just play that position. And so very rarely do you see middies who play offense face-off. But the fact that it's an attackman generally is very, very unique. I've never seen it. So Prince is going to keep coming back into it, though, because he's won all these face-offs very clean moving forward. So you stick with what works.
Here's the freshman, Mike McDonald. Alex Capretta, his man falls down. Capretta gives it up to Schreiber, who rips one right into the cross of the goalie, Brian Finn.
And I think that's the shot. Even though Schreiber has a great outside shot, I think Penn will be happy giving that up all day. It's, you know, don't overcommit running out to the outside shooter. Let them shoot there and trust your goalie, who's a very up-and-coming goalie. He's only a sophomore. And trust in him that he's going to make that stop.
When we spoke to Mike Murphy, he said that Feeney's strength is stopping those outside shots. And Princeton has a lot of outside shooters. That'll be something to watch.
And such a key for goalies, making those early stops and getting your confidence. And right now, Feely feels pretty good in cage and seeing the ball very well.
Go ahead.
Let's take a look at Penn's focus points for this game.
Yeah, go ahead.
And for Penn, I think they need to do better than they have so far this season in terms of winning faceoffs. Right now, they've only won one of the four faceoffs. And then just contain Schreiber and Fracaro. They are what makes this Princeton offense click. When they play well, Princeton generally wins. So they need to keep them and get them out of the Princeton offensive game plan.
Schwale will set up the offense. To Savage, goal line extended. Savage working on Jonathan Myers. Now a stall warning. So Penn's got to keep it in the attack box.
And you can tell that's going to be a focal point for the refs, is to make sure they try to get Penn to play offense at a faster rate.
Olinsky behind the cage on one bounce to Schwale. There's Keneally. That's an easy one for Fiorito. Here's the transition game for Princeton off of Fiorito's save. Chris Bates telling us they like to do that.
Oh, why did he pass?
In the middle, quick stick and score. Tom Schreiber.
Right down red. Great. Here comes guys replay. Red.
And what a pretty goal. It all starts with number 7, Tucker Shanley, moving it down and just tic-tac-toe. Fracaro does a nice job looking off his pass to Tommy Schreiber, cutting down the middle. And that's picture-perfect transition offense from this Princeton Tigers offense.
And Tom Schreiber is the subject of today's Sector Spiders player portfolio.
Let him go.
At his 14th goal of the season. He had 5 against Villanova last year. The first freshman ever to lead Princeton in goals and assists
in a
single
season. Quarter behind, so
he's an Under Armour All-American coming out of high school, St. Anthony's in Long Island. He can do it all, and you don't see that too often anymore, where you have these middies who can pass the ball so well, and that's what he does that differentiates him from most other players in the country.
Princeton continuing to dominate the X here. They've won 4 out of 5 faceoffs.
Nice spin move
Princeton
to get free.
Focus points. Thank you.
That was the faceoff man, Bobby Lucas, who
hold on,
head
Sean.
To the sidelines in favor
hold
of
Hold on,
Will
Sean.
2-1 Princeton.
Focus points.
Matt, what are Princeton's focus points for this afternoon?
You know, this Princeton team's leading the Ivy League in shots per game, but they're not shooting at a high enough hit rate.
Yep.
So they need to make sure that they're strategic in their shooting and shoot at
a
higher percentage.
And
then Tyler Fiorito,
thanks,
coming into the season, was up for first-team All-American. Now he's barely saving the ball at 50%. So they need him to get his confidence back, get his swag back a little bit, and make some of those stops that he's accustomed to making.
He was a second-team All-American last year, over 60%, second in the nation.
I mean, he's been a stellar goalie throughout his career, so they need him to play better if they're going to want to make a run at this Ivy League championship.
All right, side out.
Can't really miss number two in white for Seinfeld.
6'6", 250. Coming up on the
a little banged up coming into the game. Coach Bates told us he was a game time decision, but he is in there.
And I think he's key for them to be in the game because he can really stretch a defense with his shooting ability.
Stall warning now on Princeton, so they got to keep it in. Another quick stick and another score for Princeton.
I'll take 83 here. Replace here, high end zone.
Yeah, Will!
83, and then I'll take the shot here on.
And just a nice job by Will Hemmler, the midi, who is inverted behind the cage. And this is what you do when the stall warning is on. You take a midi, you invert him behind the cage, and look for him to feed. It's just a great place for them. They can see the whole field, and they can generally get their hands open. Just a nice job finding Ficarro, who's so crafty inside.
Second goal of the game for Jeff Ficarro. Remember, he's coming off a 5-goal effort in his last game against Villanova, a 14-8 Princeton win.
Or a guy
who's going to come up with it at the X?
Our guy Schreiber, huh?
Ball still loose. Cunningham's got the beat, and another face-off won by Princeton. They add another goal here. All of a sudden, that speeds Penn up a little bit, doesn't it?
It has to. It has to make them change their game plan because they're not going to want to sit and stall and take 2 to 3 minutes to try to get a goal. Being down 3 goals, you know, say Princeton does score here, that's like 6 goals against most teams because Princeton plays such good defense, and they're just not giving possessions because they're winning faceoffs. So a big, big issue here for UPenn if Princeton's able to get on the board again.
Here's Ficarro, 2 goals already. Ficarro turns, and this time fires way too high.
Ficarro is just so strong in terms of getting top side. Defensive players are told, don't let them get the top side. But with his strength, he's getting it pretty much with ease here, and he's really dangerous. And if I'm Coach Murphy, I'm maybe making a matchup change there.
Here's Alex Capretta. He's got a great outside shot. Ficarro again. Off the pick from McDonald. Ficarro switches hands. Fires off the side of the net. Ground ball scooped up by Penn and Max Meyer.
No replays here.
And that was a better job by number 38, Anthony Santomo, by really banging and battling and not letting Ficarro get that top side, forcing him underneath and taking a low percentage shot.
3-1 Princeton, 2 goals by Ficarro, 1 by Schreiber. Penn's only goal coming off the cross of the junior Tim Schwalet.
Still waiting for a side out to do promo 1A.
Ryan Parrietti.
Here we go, D!
And now it's Keneally controlling up top for Penn as they wait for Belinsky to join that midfield unit. Here is Belinsky.
Schwalet.
Pass in front. Nicely done.
Wow. Take that.
And it's Parrietti finishing.
Love the high end zone. Replay here. High end zone. 83.
And a nice job by Penn kind of taking advantage of a Princeton defense that may have been sleeping because UPenn was subbing through the midfield. But a nice job by Parrietti getting wide open inside. And then Schwalet with the great vision, just a pinpoint perfect pass. That's the key to those goals, is throwing the pass on the money.
Schwalet, a goal and an assist. And for Parrietti, that's his 6th of the season. He came into this one having scored 2 goals
he
could
forget the
in each of his last 2 games.
As a matter of fact, he could go back to slash.
Face off won by Princeton.
They're not doing anything special, so F them.
Tigers set up behind the cage for Ficarro.
He's talking.
It's funny, both
user
teams
message.
Seem to be playing the same type of offense. make sure that they're getting the right people in. The substitution piece is what takes so long in a college lacrosse game. And you know, that's what slows it down a bit. But you want to get your players on. You're transitioning from the specialty players, the D-middies, to the offensive players. So that's why it kind of takes a long time. And both teams, in order for them to run efficiently on offense, have to have the right people on the field. So that's kind of why this slowdown pace has really kind of taken shape and hold here in this game.
Our story right Shriver now is
trying to get free
with his two goals.
Princeton working on offense with a one-goal lead. And that one is picked off.
If this scores, I'll take it from the pick-off.
Transition opportunity for Penn. Here come the Quakers. Parrietti will slow things up. Zach Losko coming away with the intercept.
Uh-oh,
and now a penalty. It's going to be offsides.
Offside. How do we know that?
Okay, who we have serving?
2-2. 2-2 white, technical. Offside, 30 seconds.
Tom Schreiber offsides. Too many guys on one side of the field.
And that may happen to Princeton more so than other teams throughout the year because they're running Schreiber at attack. They're running him at midfield, and it kind of gets lost in translation and who should be staying on the offensive side of the field, because in the game of lacrosse, you always have to have three offensive players on that side of the field.
Man up chance for Penn.
Is this a good freeze to talk about that offside? Yeah, you got it.
Keneally.
All right, so hold that there on blue. That's the offside that he's talking about. Good stuff. Yeah, I'll take it. Man up user.
A few seconds left. Adler will uncork one. Schwale there. Penn still has it, but unable to score in that 30-second EMO.
And so only a few seconds left on the man up here. You're going to look for Penn to run kind of a set play right out of the break here, where you're looking to draw and dump it and really get a step-down shooter.
Schwale, a goal and an assist, controlling behind the cage. Savage ties it up at three.
And goal is by number 20, Dan Savage.
Yeah, and 85 replays here. Red.
And this is a nice job by Penn. While it won't go down as a man-up goal because the penalty just expired, a lot of times defenses have a tough time matching up. And you can see there Dan 85. Savage just gets lost, steps in with a great over-the-top fundamental shot. You know, as an outside shooter, that is key. Over the top, all the young kids watching, do not shoot low to high. Shoot over and to the ground. Change plans. Changing plans is so key.
The offside is obviously dead, Jeff, on blue. But thank you for holding it.
Lucas and Feeney at the X, and another face-off won by Princeton. Penn has only won one draw so far in this game.
Wow.
It's kind of been the story of not just this season, but the last 2 years for Penn.
You know, at the end of the day, goalie play, face-offs, and ground balls. I don't care how skilled you are offensively. It comes down to the
possessions.
It comes down to possessions. You know, the 2 years I won the national championship at UVA, we led the country in ground balls. The 1 year we were 5-8, we weren't even in the conversation.
Yeah, Tillman Johnson.
Thank you for reminding me.
Yeah, he was pretty good.
Cool.
Grossman finds Fricaro. They have the long pole Santomo on him. There's Schreiber, Kashansky, trying to keep him in his crosshairs. And Schreiber rushed a shot there.
Kashansky's doing one heck of a job on Schreiber right now. Every shot he's taking is contested. He's not getting his hands free.
Not on 85
that just
there.
Speaks to the player he is.
Yeah.
And that's going to be on Princeton, so Penn will have it.
Get ready for it.
And right
here.
There, that was a moving pick. In general, you have to have your feet set, much like in basketball. And that's something that's going to happen, too, to Princeton. They love to do those two-man games, set a lot of picks. And sometimes when someone's moving around, it's tough to get your feet set.
Max Meyer, that's a risky pass, and that is a Penn turnover.
You can see right now in this game, Princeton has 13 ground balls to UPenn 6.
Nah, pass.
While the score may be tied at 3-3, if those numbers continue to trend that way, you're going to find Princeton on the winning end of the scoreboard.
What's going on here? No, I thought he was going to call a timeout.
Wiedmeyer, long outlet to the long stick, Mitty Cunningham. The long stick midi is sort of becoming the glamour position in lacrosse, isn't it?
It really is, because you love to see great defensive players, but these kids on the offense with a long stick are so good on offense, too. You know, you look at a Brody Merrill in the pros.
Well, he was the first one that comes to mind that sort of changed it.
Him and Kyle Sweeney, both Georgetown graduates, have kind of changed that. And now you're not just asking your long stick to take the best midi out of the game, but also to produce on the offensive side in transition.
I mean, we see Kashansky, Joel White, who was at Syracuse, Karolunas last year at Villanova. Cunningham's a great one for Princeton.
Now what?
And a timeout for Princeton with 4:53 to go.
Going to break
here in the second quarter. 10, we've got a good one. Ivy League
9,
opener between
8,
Penn and Princeton.
7,
all
6,
square at 3.
5. He's gone. You can roll it. Go, you break. All right, here's what we can do coming back from break. Promo. All right. Here's our traffic. Promo one, and then the logo fly. Yeah, but I'll answer them. Yes, logo fly first. Logo fly, then promo. All right, here's our traffic coming back, guys. We're going to do an Old Spice logo fly, and then promo one. Okay, so we're under 30 back. 30. Yes. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Old Spice logo. Go, Anish.
Welcome back to Old Spice College Lacrosse.
And
Princeton and Penn all tied up at 3 here in the second quarter. Don't forget, the college softball season begins tonight at 6 Eastern on ESPNU.
Good decision, Sean.
We've got an SEC showdown, Ole Miss against number 2 Alabama. Then at 8 Eastern,
that's
college baseball, ACC game between Virginia and 6th-ranked
Florida State.
Play. College softball tonight at 6 Eastern and college baseball at 8 on ESPNU. Matt, you're a Virginia grad. My condolences after your UVA basketball team got beat. I'll say it politely.
They baby steps, right? We made the tournament this year.
That's
so
right. Tony Bennett getting his team into the tournament.
Next year, national championship.
Oh, exactly. Now I want halftime stories,
please.
We
got one in lacrosse. Virginia, the defending champs.
On your punt, too.
In lacrosse, that was an unlikely run to the title given the distractions and the injuries. But Dime Stars, you rallied that team. And one of the more unlikely runs, considering what they've been through. If you said at the start of the season Virginia was going to win it all, nobody was looking at you like you were crazy, but they almost lost to Bucknell in their first-round game. Capretta, he's got a big shot, and that's wide, but Princeton there to back up. Ficarro racing to the end line. There's Ficarro spinning.
They're quick to restart.
He's got two goals already, nearly lost it.
Save
by Feeney on the shot by Tucker Shanley.
Good angle of the
save. And you can see UPenn is going to keep playing this kind of condensed defense where they're going to get out the outside shots. And a lot of teams seem to be making that move in terms of whether you're playing a zone or kind of that condensed man on man.
Never mind.
You're trying to get beat by outside shots. Don't give them the easy ones on the doorstep.
Zach Lasko, part of that second midfield unit. This is Keneally. He's on a short stick. A lot of times we'll see the long stick.
Right now I'm thinking of
Princeton's made the adjustment. They now have Cunningham back on Keneally, so clearly that's a matchup they want to continue to have throughout the game.
Schwale.
I want to show him the package.
Savage lost driver.
Yeah, you can add. Yeah, you can add. You can lose a player up the
20
top
to blue.
And then add the goal at the end. That's something that we can rehash with the edge.
Attackman, but a former midfielder moved to attack earlier in the year.
And he seems to be playing very, very well at the attack spot. You know, he hasn't had a dodging goal yet, but he looks comfortable in position. A lot of times you see when you make that switch, you'll protect the stick well, and things happen.
Pass to the middle results in a turnover. Here's the long pole, Cunningham. Shovels it off. Shanley. He's a big kid. But another save by Feeney.
Yeah, holding on red.
You're shaking your head.
And that was kind of one of those things I mentioned in the opus on the focus point was shoot at a higher percentage. Take the right shot, not the first shot. And right there, number 7, Shanley comes down and just fires one without his feet set, without the offensive personnel in. And any coach values possession more than a potential goal on a shot like that.
Arrietty trying to shake Costello.
Gets
it to
Schwalbe.
But we're good at the pace of this game. It's pretty impressive. And at the right
coming up
time,
on 2 minutes to play here in the first half. We're tied at three. Ivy League opener between Princeton and Penn. The Quakers have not won at Princeton since 1988.
Serious history there.
Arrietty to Savage. And once again, top.
Go ahead, you can pop
on the attack box. Here's Adler. He's trying to get that right hand free. Savage doubled. Nice play by Fiorito coming out of the goal to pick it off.
And that was a great job by Fiorito. I actually really think it saved the goal because Penn had drawn a lot of attention, a lot of slides, and they had made that pass to X. They were going to have a step-down shot on the backside. Fiorito saw that, knew he only had one outlet, stepped out there, made a very crucial play for this Princeton defense.
Fiorito, Cunningham, and now Orban, the freshman, into the attack box. Finding Schreiber. 60 seconds to play in the half, and Feeney tracks that one down, and a flag goes up. That's going to be a 1 minute penalty. It's going to be slashing on Max Meyer.
Halftime stories here.
Coming up on the Warrior Halftime Report, Matt's going to give you his best units in the nation, best attack, best midfield, best defense, and we will preview the second of our lacrosse doubleheader here on ESPNU, a terrific top five matchup between Syracuse and Johns Hopkins. But right now, Princeton with a chance to go up at the half. They've got an extra man opportunity for the balance of this second quarter.
Our focus here is for Caro, all right?
I'm Princeton. I'm patient on the man up. You have the full minute. Let's make sure that we get the last possession of this half.
Here's Sonnenfeld.
Go ahead.
McDonald. Shanley.
Yep.
Shanley with a left hand. Wide.
And something to point out here, UPenn has decided to take the strategy of shutting off Tommy Schreiber, so basically removing him from the equation on the man up. And so what you do is you then play a 5-on-4, not a 6-on-5.
We're going to break here.
Timeout. Penn with 27 seconds to go in the first half. When we come back, Princeton on the EMO.
Here's our traffic coming back. Here's our traffic. Promo 2. Promo 2, and then they're playing. Promo 2 straight out of break. Hold on a second. No score needed. Promo 2 straight out of break, and then they're playing. Here's our traffic coming back. Promo 2, and then we're playing. Straight out of break. Go lacrosse theme. No, promo. I'm sorry, promo 3. Promo 3. Promo 3, guys. Promo 3. Gotcha. Okay, under 20 left. Quick mention, just reference our bug clock, just because it's just a little off there. All right, so promo 3 here in 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and go, Anish.
Next Saturday on ESPNU, a pair of exciting college lacrosse matchups. It starts at noon Eastern, ACC battle, 8th-ranked Maryland against 12th-ranked North Carolina. And then at 2 Eastern, possibly a championship preview, the top two teams in the nation, Johns Hopkins and Virginia.
So the players
Matt
coming
Ward,
off
Schrock, 3-3,
is
Princeton,
10 white
and Penn
and
Tigers
blue, okay? 10
on
white,
the man up for the balance of this second quarter.
Mm-hmm. At the end of
close look, and Grossman puts it in, and Princeton has the lead.
I'm going to use 83 here. Okay.
Looked like Penn just fell asleep.
Over there real time. Replace here for the high end. 83 real time.
McDonald. And it's just one of those things where Penn decided to shut off Tommy Schreiber. Then is a 5-on-4. personally, I think it's easier to score this way. You can see McDonald just steps up and finds Grossman on the inside, who buries it with ease. He catches it in his left hand, his dominant hand, and his key. He buries it to the side of the goal. He reached around UPenn's goalie, Feeney, and made a great, great shot.
Going to halftime, I'm going to give you Fracaro.
Santomo way too late to slide there, so Princeton with a one-goal lead. They're facing off with Fracaro again, but it's controlled by the freshman, Battalion. Only the second face-off won by Penn.
Now what?
And now the Quakers want a timeout. Here with a little more than 10 seconds to play in the first half, down a goal.
Standby break here.
And with the score 4-3, we're going to step aside quickly. We'll come back with the conclusion of the first half.
Boy, we're getting all these breaks in quickly. I can't even do stuff coming out because we only have 10 seconds left. Here is our traffic coming back. We'll do score. We'll let them play. And then at halftime, I'm going to give you a shot of Fracaro, number 10, and Savage, number 20. And I'll give you a 15 count to break. Less than 15 back to us. 8, 7, 6. That's right. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Go, Anish.
Pennsylvania looking for its first win at Princeton since 1988. They beat the Tigers at Franklin Field last year. That snapped a 21-game losing streak.
No. We got 10 seconds left here. It's okay.
Right now, down a goal. They just called timeout with 10 seconds to go in the first half. Anish Shroff, Matt Ward with you. And, Matt, who do you want to see with the ball in their cross for Penn?
If I'm Penn, I'm going to either go to Dan Savage or number three, Schwale, to try and create. They're the ones who can kind of handle the one-on-one matchups. And surprise, Princeton didn't come out in a zone here. A lot of teams with 10 seconds left really like doing that.
Here is Savage, 5 seconds. Savage doubled, gives it up. Fiorito comes up with it, and the first half is in the books.
Here's a shot of Fracaro.
Jeff Fracaro, 5 goals in his last game, 2 more in the first half for Princeton.
12,
Dan
11,
Savage, though,
10,
with a goal
9,
for Penn. It's 4-3 Tigers
7,
at
6,
the half.
5. All right, halftime segment that's recorded. Let's go. All right. Great half, guys. Something to think about. We got a package on Schreiber on what he's done today. I can show you that during the next break. And also for Caro, a package on him. But I'm thinking we'll stick with the edge.
Welcome to the Warrior Halftime Report. Today. We're at the Clash of 1952 Stadium in Princeton, New Jersey with Matt Ward and Ish Schroff. And Matt, we look at some of the top units in the nation. Let's start on attack.
Yeah, let me show you the package when we after the next break. I'll show you. All right, you're good with your shots here with... What's up, Sean? Yes. Yes. Out sticks with the second segment. And then, guys. So, guys, at some point, I want you to go out, and we're going to go back on sticks for the second segment of halftime, okay? So you could make your way out there anytime you want, and then we can talk during the break of this first segment.
Okay, so 214, we could only second.
All right. This is Bob Whitelaw's show here. I've already done the content. It's up for Bob to hit the shots.
Welcome to the Warrior Halftime Report. We're at the Clash of 1952 Stadium in Princeton, New Jersey with Matt Ward and Ish Schroff. And Matt, we look at some of the top units in the nation. Let's start on attack. We got to start with Virginia, and that means the reigning Towarton Trophy winner, Steele Stanhope.
Yeah, any attack unit that has Steele Stanhope on it is set for a great season. He can pass,
feed. Sean,
and they also have a very
underrated
player,
right?
Matt Bachlett, who has just the absolute talent to finish the
Thank
ball
you.
With ease. And look at these passes from Steel Stanhope, who can't finish those shots. You know, he's a player I would love to play with.
How about what Bill Tierney's doing in Denver with his attack?
What a fun attack unit this is. Mark Matthews is the craftiest player in college lacrosse, and he has a great quarterback, and Alex Demonopoulos, who can get him the ball in the appropriate places.
Virginia last year won a championship, did it without the Bratton brothers down the stretch. They have one of the best midfields again this year.
I think this is what makes Virginia so tough, is they can beat you from the attack, and they can beat you from the midfield. They have Emery, and they have Colin Briggs, your traditional middies who can just rip from the outside, but they can also invert with White and Cochran.
Exactly.
They just have so many different weapons in the midfield.
What makes Maryland's midfield so dangerous?
I think it's depth. They have six players that can go out there and beat you. You know, Drew Snyder's off to a great start to his senior year. And you look at Brent Holmes. He, to me, is their MVP. He's winning the face-off. He's pushing the transition. He's a great competitor.
On defense, usual suspects.
Yeah, Johns Hopkins, I think it all starts with their head coach, Dave Petromala, the best player on the defensive side this game's ever seen. And he's got a great one in Tucker Dirk, and he's, in my opinion, having the best season of any defenseman.
At
this point, he really takes control and gets everyone playing on the same page. They're very well coached and just play solid team defense.
And then Notre Dame.
This is just becoming a rite of passage for Notre Dame. It's the fifth year. At this point, they've been in the top five in goals against. They have a system in place. They have a great goaltender and John Kemp. Great defense for Notre Dame.
When we come back on the Warrior Halftime Report, we're going to preview a matchup between two top five teams, Syracuse and Johns Hopkins. That's coming up next. This Halftime Report is presented by Warrior.
So welcome back
All
to Warrior Halftime.
Warrior.com.
Okay. Score. And then I'm going to do a video promo. It's a video promo of the game. Okay. Coming up after our game, blah, 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 blah. Put you on camera. And then, yes, you can tee up the key players, starting with Desco.
How are we tagging the segment?
Out of that, I'm coming out with a graphic that I'm about to show you right now.
Okay.
Give me the series history. It's the series history between Syracuse and Hopkins.
Okay.
And that's where you can tag over that.
Okay.
Font two in for me, please. Okay, that's what the series history looks like.
Okay, and then we'll just lay out to break?
No, then it'll be a score, and I'll give you a count.
Okay.
Give you a count to break.
And then is there anything in the next block or the second half
second
next?
Second half when we come back.
Okay, perfect.
Yep. Good job, guys. Good half. Yes. All right, let's reset here and let's get ready. 1 minute, gentlemen.
Just tee me up.
Yes, you can do theme. You could keep that theme going, too. The video promo, does that have music on it already?
Yes.
Okay, great. Okay.
Canadian.
That's fine. That's fine. 4 o'clock.
Warrior one more time, right?
Yes. Exactly. It's on 83. 30 back, guys.
Okay.
It's on 83. Video promo is on 83.
Billboard's 85.
Okay.
At the end. And red has the packages.
Yep. It's a playlist.
Yep.
Under 15.
Oh, 8. 7. 6. How much for under 15? 5. 4. 3. 2. Welcome back, Warrior. And go, Anish.
Welcome back to the Warrior Halftime Report. Our score here in Princeton, New Jersey. It is the Princeton Tigers 4 and the Penn Quakers
83
3.
Ivy
League opener
promo
for both teams.
83.
Coming up immediately following our game, a terrific matchup between two top five teams. 5th-ranked Syracuse
on
and number
next
2, Johns Hopkins. Here on ESPNU, it comes your way at 4 Eastern.
Go ahead.
Alongside the former Tewartin Trophy winner and former All-American at Virginia, Matt Ward.
Stand by red here.
Matt, as we preview the Syracuse-Johns Hopkins game. Syracuse, a very young team. Hopkins, they look every bit the part of a title contender. Give us a guy to watch on both teams.
You know, for Syracuse, I think you look at that senior leadership on the offensive end, and it's Timmy Desco. He is a lefty who can finish.
Stand by, Palmer's
going to
be next
year. What's been impressive for this year is I think he's really stepped up his dodging ability. And then just look at the creativity here. I heard it called the Canadian egg roll.
Palmer.
And it was an amazing goal.
Go ahead.
And then on the flip side for Johns Hopkins, you have Zach Palmer, who's actually Canadian, plays left-handed. He shoots the ball so well from the outside, but he's a great passer. You can see it, 8 points on 3 goals and 5 assists in his last matchup against UMBC.
It also promises to be a contrast in styles. We know Syracuse, even with Cleveland Rodgers as the defensive coordinator, they still like to go up and down. Hopkins, of course, known for his defense. This will be the 50th meeting between these two storied programs. And Syracuse, after Dave Pietramala had their number for so long, the Orange have won the last 5 meetings against the Blue Jays.
Breaking.
Again, the score here in Princeton, it's the Tigers leading Penn 4-3 in the Ivy League opener for both teams. Second half is next.
85.
This halftime report is presented by Warrior. All hail Warrior.com.
So what, I got a minute, 90 seconds here, right? So that's doing this. All right, cue up the Shriver package. Here's what I need coming back, guys. Here's what I need coming back.
Okay, we need the Old Spice logo tonight.
Here's what we got coming back, guys. You go back to headsets there. Old Spice. Score. Cue up Shriver package. Yeah, run a line. Hey, guys, you got a... Here's a look at the Shriver package. Red here.
1 minute.
Do you have an Edge, an update? But is it a user? Oh, Jesus. Some kind of stats or something? Give me the focus points update. It's great. Can you? I need that for coming up. All right, guys, so here's the traffic coming back. We got an Old Spice logo fly. Score. Are you good with the Shriver package? All right, great. Yeah, exactly. Shriver package. And Shriver having a, you know, one of our Edge guys, Shriver, here's how he's done.
Let's revisit the Edge top Shriver. So we're not doing Kashansky?
No, we're not doing Kashansky, just Shriver.
Okay.
15 left, and then after Shriver, we'll revisit the focus points. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and go Old Spice.
Welcome back to Old Spice College Lacrosse here at Princeton. It's the home team leading 4-3 at the half, and Princeton star midfielder,
Shriver,
the sophomore Tom Shriver,
Red,
he's had his hands full in the first half, does have a goal, but been guarded well by Will Kashansky.
Yeah, and you can see here, Will Kashansky, a major league lacrosse product or prospect, has done a nice job on Shriver, but he has been able to get his hands free.
There.
Let a couple get away from him. You can see the ball slipped out of his stick. But here it is, right here. Just, he knows it all. He can pass, he can feed, and he's deceptively good off the ball.
Matt, let's revisit Penn's focus points.
Yeah, you look at the improve on faceoffs. Well, that hasn't happened. They've had a tough go of it here, only winning 2 of the 9 faceoffs. And then Shriver and Ficarro, they've done a nice job limiting Ficarro to one goal. Shriver to one goal, but Ficarro's really stepped up with 2 goals and 1 assist.
Ficarro's been hot. He had 5 goals against Villanova in the last win for Princeton, and 2 already in the first half to go along with the assist, as you talked about. For Princeton, their focus points.
You know, Princeton come out, shoot at a high percentage. They're not executing. They're only at 20%. When they shoot the ball as much as they do, they need to capitalize more. And then Fiorillo hasn't been tested. Three goals with two saves. He's under 50%. But that kind of doesn't tell the story. He just hasn't been tested. So he needs to kind of stay composed and be ready to get kind of more shots and more action here in the
first
second half.
First half stats.
Let's take a look at the first half stats in this one goal game. The shot disparity, it looks massive, but that's almost to be expected given the style of play these two teams like.
Yeah, and the number of shots Princeton is actually getting as a result of these ground balls in the faceoffs. They're dominating with small plays all over the field, so they're only up one, but I really believe if the game continues to go the way it does today, has in the first half, Penn's going to be looking up at the end of the game, looking up at the scoreboard.
And his 2 goals today, Red.
And meanwhile, the star offensively for Princeton in that first half.
Jeff Ricard, you can see there, he's a crafty dodger from the attack spot where he can go left, he can
go right.
He's got nice vision. He's able to feed inside. And what I don't think you're going to see in this caption here, those, the, you know, that promo there is, he's been winning faceoffs. He's won three or four faceoffs today. So he really is doing it all for Princeton. And while Schreiber hasn't had the game that I think
guys,
he would expect to have,
Ficarro's
really elevating his game
shit.
And kind
that
of taking that burden on himself.
And if this comes down to possessions, the first half we saw Princeton controlling the X, winning seven
thumbs
of the
up,
nine
baby.
Faceoffs. And as we talked about in the first half, the rarity to see an attackman taking faceoffs like Ficarro does, but he's been successful at it at times this year. He was terrific a few times for Princeton. He's 5 of 8 on the draws coming in, and they put him in some big spots, did it against Johns Hopkins. It worked.
The one thing that would concern me as a coach is will that wear him down on the offensive end? Because at this point, he really is your best initiator from the attack spot.
Yep.
So you want to limit how many he actually does, but on the critical, crucial possession faceoffs, I'd send him out there, but you don't want to rely on him too heavily because that is hard work being down there and kind of grinding it out and really takes a toll on your legs and your arms. So
yes,
they just need to be about smart how they kind of implement that strategy.
Mike Murphy's defense has done a good job on Schreiber in the first half.
I mean,
when we
know,
talked to Chris
one,
Bates, he said
time
sometimes
going.
If teams will slide
right,
on him, we'll
I
move him to
on.
The attack. Is that something you may expect to see from Princeton in the second half?
Okay. Yeah, okay. I think you'll see him all over the field. And I think it works with him because he is such a good passer. He has 11 assists on the season. And that's why he has the ability to do that.
I love winging it.
And the opening faceoff of the second half, controlled by Princeton. So now 8 out of 10 at the X.
That's,
and here is the face-off man, Bobby
big,
Lucas.
Jeff, the face-offs, I wonder if we could do like a face-off package.
Only a face-off get-off,
Penn
and now he does get
one face-off.
In comes Schreiber.
You know, the game of lacrosse is a game of runs where teams can, you know, you're down by 3 or 4 with 10 minutes left. You're not out of the game. However, I kind of feel in this game, if Princeton's able to get a 2 or 3 goal lead here in the second half, it's going to be a heck of a time for Penn to try to kind of claw their way back into the game because they just haven't had enough possessions.
It seemed in the first half that Princeton a few times was on the verge of going on that run, but Penn wouldn't allow it.
You know, Penn's been opportunistic on the offensive end, doing a nice job. Goalie's made a couple of nice saves. But, again, I just don't think they have the firepower to kind of overcome a large deficit. So they need to make a big stop here and really keep Princeton off the scoreboard for the foreseeable future.
Minute into the third quarter. Here's Tucker Shanley. And he rips the back of the net.
Very nice.
Great big goal.
Whatever.
Tucker Shanley. 13-52.
ISO here on 85.
Tigers lead
85. Thank you. I'll take blue.
And just a nice job by Shanley here. Stepping up. That's the key going up the
blue.
Field. He's able to beat number 22, Lasco. And the key here, look, step up the field, protect your stick, get that extra angle. And that was the key to that awesome take to the cage by Tucker Shanley.
He found the angle, gets his 9th goal of the season.
Sorry, I'm giving you tape numbers.
When he uncorks it, a lot of power behind that shot. He's 6'4", 210, junior out of Fairfield, Connecticut. Another draw. Well, that was almost won by Princeton. It looked like Myers had it, but it comes to Savage.
And I think that's where UPenn has to step their game up. I don't think they're going to be winning the clamp and the clean in that aspect. But the faceoff's not over until the possession is in the offensive side of the field. So they need their wings to step up, put all kinds of pressure on the Princeton long sticks and middies, trying to pick up those ground balls off the faceoff. That's how they're going to make up that discrepancy in the faceoff X, in my opinion.
We saw Princeton rally from 2 goals down earlier in this game. They trailed 3-1, then scored 2 unanswered to tie it at 3 before Princeton got a goal in the final minute of the first half on a man up. There's Savage, goal line extended. Up top, Keneally fires wide.
And that was nice offense by UPenn, doing a nice job initiating from the midfield with Keneally and then with the initial dodger and then moving it down to Savage, who found a step-down shot from Keneally. So you just got to get that on cage, but sound a fundamental offense right there.
Yeah. Adler, top of the attack box, now moves in.
Charge.
Yeah, that one way too high. Schwale there to back up. Tim Schwale, right, number 3 for the Penn Quakers.
I'll take font 2.
The quarterback for that offense, he didn't play last year. Took the year off, and this is an Ivy League thing. You and I won't be familiar with this. For academic development, wanted to test his chops as an investment banker. Tried that, liked it, and decided to come back to school, play a little lacrosse.
And now he has a summer internship lined up for up in New York, so it seemed to have worked out. He's really come into form. It's always tough to take time away from the game that you love, but it was something he wanted to explore, and it certainly worked out for him.
Here's Adler. In close, Belinsky couldn't quite corral it, and Savage can't track it down. Princeton ball. Yeah, to go back to
Schwale, Mike Murphy telling us he returned to the team as one of the better athletes on the team, so he stayed in shape during that year off.
And that's incredibly impressive. I remember after my junior year, I moved up to New York, did a summer internship, and
so we're sitting
certainly
on
didn't come back in the type of shape I probably should have. And I think I get reminded of that down in Virginia every time I'm down there. You know, kudos for him to coming in the best shape of anyone on the team after a whole year off. That shows determination, a lot of work ethic, and just kind of shows how committed to the game he is, even though he wasn't playing.
There's Shanley, who scored the last goal. Fires another one. That's two in a row.
Give me real time on 83 here. Give me 83 back.
Second goal.
Retake it. 83 real time, and then I'll go red.
Just a nice job. Shanley getting a full head of steam. He burns by Richards and just buries it. That is picture-perfect placement. If you want to beat the goalie 99 out of 100 times, that's where you put the ball off hip. It's the toughest place for the goalie to get his stick across his body to make that stop.
10 goals on the season for Shanley. Here's a guy that Chris Bates said the sky is the limit for him.
Good one. Good face.
The team's really locked down on Ficarro and Schreiber. He's got a chance to be the X-Factor.
They want it.
Second straight face-off won by Penn. Now they have it knocked away. Ball still loose. And Princeton comes away with it. Derek Raby fell down. Who's got it? It will be Princeton ball.
Is this a side out?
And that's what I was talking about earlier. Penn needs to start winning those scraps on the ground ball. They didn't. You know, they didn't pick it up cleanly, and they really made Princeton work 85. For it and ultimately earn the ball back. It's those little effort play plays here. That make the difference.
85.
Penn ball, rather. It is Penn ball. So Penn has it down three.
No, they're playing.
Less than 4 minutes into this third quarter, Tucker Shanley, two goals for Princeton.
And then I can get that promo in.
Turning a one-goal game into a three-goal advantage.
If she could be faster with that, if she knew, you know, as soon as she knows, boom, chime in. That's a side out. I'm telling you, relay to her.
Spacing here by
Penn. That's fine. As soon as she knows, relay it. I don't care.
Wasco. And now Savage will take it up top. Looks like we're seeing an invert here.
In the fourth quarter.
Yeah, this is the second midfield group for UPenn, so they probably have a strategy in place where a lot of times the second unit is that invert. Take the midi behind the cage and kind of a lot of former converted attackmen now playing midfield. And so for them, this is a key possession, so a lot of trust from Coach Murphy to put these kids in at this juncture in the game.
Well, they've got Savage back at the midfield position. He's been playing a lot of attack. And it's going to be Princeton ball.
Let's see what happened there. Got it on 83 there. What happened? Okay. Here's a replay of what happened. UView. Left side here. 83.
All right, let's take a look at UView.
See here, you can see here Savage just kind of gets held up, loses the ball, and the foul is committed right there where he starts to lean on him. Didn't have his stick in his hand. I'm going to call that every single time.
Oh, and how about that? Another goal by Princeton. That's four unanswered by the Tigers. Chris White.
I'll take 83. Replay. 83. How's a shot on blue? Is it better on blue? Red's
and just
better?
A nice job by
shot
White stepping into one. Lefty hard. And the key here, he's a defensive midi. You love to get points from your defensive midis. They make the difference in the game on the defensive side. But when they start contributing on the offensive end, watch out.
Got a timeout. We're going to break.
We've got three goals in a little more than 5 minutes for Princeton to open the second half. And the Tigers with a four-goal cushion.
One. How long is this break here? 1 minute. Can we tie those three goals together real quick? Gotcha. Hey, right now we're working on the three goals back to back to back. So what we can do is come back with promo four, the Warrior Classic, and then the package on the three bang 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 goals. Great. Let me know if they're ready, Jeff. If not, then I'll just let them play. Great. How much back? Right on the line, please. Put right on the line. Here, guys. Here's a look.
Keep on it, keep on it, keep on it.
All right, Riku here. 8-7 promo. 5-4-3-2-1. Go, Anish.
Check out the third annual ESPNU Warrior Classic Saturday, April 14th, in Charlotte, North Carolina. Doubleheader event featuring Syracuse and Rutgers in the first game, and Hofstra and North Carolina in the second game. It all takes place at American Legion Memorial Stadium, home of the Charlotte Hounds of Major League Lacrosse. Get your tickets now by calling 704-980-2999 or visit ESPNUWarriorClassic.com for more info. Princeton, three quick goals here in the first 5-plus minutes of the second half. All similar goals.
One of our keys was for them to shoot a high percentage in the first half. Not so much, shooting 20%. It's closer to 100% here in the second half. They got two goals from Shanley, and then an unexpected contributor, Chris White, just drills one from the outside.
7-3, and when you go back to the final goal of the second half by Mike Grossman, it's four unanswered for Princeton, but Penn controls the draw here.
Yep.
All right, as it's a four-goal deficit for Penn now, that patience that they like to preach offensively, how do you change the approach?
I wouldn't give up quite yet. They've won the last three faceoffs, so there is hope that they're improving that area and can get extended possessions. But right there, you can't afford sloppy turnovers. And eventually, Princeton continues to play this way defensively. They're just going to have to start pushing it, taking risks up and down the field.
Fiorito coming way out. Gives it up to Myers. Princeton's got to get it into the attack box. Kip Orban as Princeton clears.
Yeah, 1A on your back.
Here's Tom Schreiber, the do-it-all midi number 22.
Probably.
Now Will Himmler controlling up top.
So if we get into a case that we have to fill,
this is gut-wrench time for this UPenn defense. They need a stop. Have to regain the momentum and give their offense another chance to get on the scoreboard. It's been too long for them.
Ivy League opener for both these teams. Princeton 3-2 on the season. Penn 1-3.
Great, just a track of
coming against North Carolina.
More lacrosse.
For Carl, two goals and an assist in the first half. Hammer didn't find a cutter. Schoenfeld, the big guy. He just went through two defenders. Here's Schreiber. Himmler was looking for Orban. It would have been a good pass if it connected.
Yeah, you would have had a good look.
Yeah, that was pretty offense by Princeton. A nice skip back, skip pass by Schreiber up top. Ficarro didn't like the shot and threw it inside. They just need to connect on that. And that's something, maybe not today, but they want to excel into May, into the national championship picture. Those are the plays you got to connect on. So they need to not just kind of rest in their laurels. They're up 7-3 today. They're building something great here, and they need to really take advantage of every opportunity.
Keneally to Savage. His shot blocked. Now it's Parrietti. Schwale has been the playmaker for Penn. He's had his hand in all three goals, scored one, assisted on the other two.
Package would work.
And here is Schwale.
Jeff for later.
And you saw John Cunningham on him, the terrific long stick midi.
And right now, if I'm Penn, you can see Keneally is being guarded by a short stick. Get him the ball in the right place. He's the one you want to have initiating your offense. Like right here is a great opportunity for him to dodge.
Keneally on Nick Fernandez. Had it poked away, recovers. Fernandez, one of their top short stick D middies for Princeton, number 24. All right, Velasco.
We'll wait till Princeton gets that ball back.
And now a stall warning. We're waiting for
it. It's a user.
So Penn's got to keep it in. Schwale tries a swim move. Parrietti lost it. And I believe he was in the crease.
Let me see if he's in the crease.
Hold on, Princeton.
Yeah, it was one of those ones where Number 21, Perietti, was going to the crease and got tripped up, and the Princeton player fell on him. Regardless, he didn't push him to the ground. That's still going to be a interference with holding call on Princeton. That's why Penn maintains
right,
possession.
Stall warning back in effect. We talked to Chris Bates about this pace of play, speeding it up, and Chris told us that normally he wouldn't be a proponent of the shot clock, but he said something's got to be done as that goes off the cross.
Let me see it hit the pike.
And it'll be Princeton ball. Nice hustle to the end line by Wiedemeyer. Quickly off the restart. Here comes Cunningham.
All right, I'm through the replay. Replay's over.
Right, now with a four-goal lead,
stand by there on your edge update. Get ready for user fun here. Here's an update on the edge. Kashansky and Shriver is going to pop up. Go ahead.
We highlighted Will Kashansky and Tom Shriver off the top of our broadcast. Kashansky has been all over Shriver, who does have the one goal.
If you were to ask me who, if this was a boxing match, I would say Kashansky has kind of won that matchup. Shriver has that one goal, but it was off a cut. It wasn't a one-on-one dodge. Kashansky's done a great job getting on his hands.
Himmler, and that was saved by Brian Feeney.
And that's not the type of shot you want. Now you're up 7-3. Shots are even more critical now. You don't want to give Penn the ball and let them have the opportunity to come back. Smarter shooting is so key for this Princeton team.
You can't do that either. Another turnover as Penn tried to get cute on the clear. Loose ball scooped up by Myers. And here comes Princeton, unsettled.
I'll take it for when the unsettled starts at this score.
Picked up by Max Meyer.
And I think that's the difference between you see Shriver and him. Shriver's the more veteran experience, maybe a little more talented player. He realized not to push it in transition. Let's maintain possession and not take unforced shots.
Well, we saw Meyer on Shriver. Now Kashansky goes to check him. Meyer, number four for Penn. Terrific as a freshman last year. He was a preseason All-American this year. Got hurt toward the end of last year. Missed Penn's playoff game. Missed the last two games this year with an injury, but back today. Here's Alex Capretta. He can shoot it from the outside as well.
Penn gets the ball. Let's discuss their non-schedule, their non-conference schedule.
Shriver, Kashansky giving him no room.
Get your tombstone of the non-conference
schedule. Shriver finally
schedule.
Gets free. And his shot hit a Penn player, and here come the Quakers.
Well, here we go here.
Hey, Harrietti
from the unsettled.
Unsettled chance for Penn if they want it, but they'll slow it up.
Nope, of course they'll slow it up. Bastards. Not print, but
less than 3 minutes to play here in this third quarter.
I keyed them to talk about it. No.
Ivy League opener. One of three Ivy League games this weekend. His conference play heating up.
Now he's talking Ivy news and notes.
He also got Yale and Cornell and Brown at Harvard. Schwale.
You want to talk their non-conference or you want to talk the Ivy League in the top 20?
A goal and two assists so far. Schwale, pass to the middle. That was Meyer again. That's his second shot, the long pole.
You got it. Okay, give me the Ivy now, the Ivy League in the top 20. Yep.
You're Penn, I'm not sure you want, we know Meyer's a terrific athlete, but that's probably not the guy you want taking that shot.
Yeah, generally when you're set on offense, you'd like to leave the shooting to your short sticks. I know there's talented players, but again,
the conversation
for Penn,
the
for
Ivy
me
League,
right here, it's always key to win the end of quarters in games, and I always kind of designate that last 2 minutes. So Penn can put a run together here, get at least one goal or maybe two. This game is back to something that's within reach. But again, if they get sloppy here, and Princeton capitalized in the last 2 minutes, you know, this game's all but over.
Schwale working on the short stick. Jack Strabo shoots low.
Oh, promo
race
here.
To the end line. Penn retains possession.
Promo here. Promo.
Check out the third annual
ESPNU Warrior Classic Saturday, April 14th in Charlotte. That's going to be a terrific matchup when we have that for you on the U. Four great teams. We also have college softball and college baseball tonight on ESPNU. Ole Miss taking on Alabama, and then Virginia, Florida State. College baseball is the late game.
Good, good catch. Good caught, because they gave you the wrong card.
Schwale, and he throws it over the head of Machucky. Schwale kind of shrugs his shoulders. My bad.
Here's the counter punch from Princeton. Nice job by
so
Florida.
And if
I'm
score,
Coach Bates, potentially get in trouble, call a timeout.
No. We're staying. Okay. Stop.
And it looks like it was a careless mistake by, I think, Tommy Schreiber. Stepped in the crease, giving Penn a fortunate break after such a sloppy pass. Usually you're not rewarded like that. If you make a bad, sloppy, careless play, teams make you pay for it.
Teams
you don't
make you
just
pay.
Casually step in the crease like that. So very fortunate for you, Penn.
I'm give him a,
Penn has
a
yet to score here in the second
half.
We're in the final minute of the third quarter.
It's going to be red. Red,
7-3
red all the way.
Princeton. They've scored the last
red,
four goals of the game.
Red.
Princeton with a win would match its win total from a year ago when they went 4-8 in what was really a season where they were just ravaged by injuries.
When I get into when I start five,
this is a Princeton team that's
five,
dangerous.
You can roll
just the way
music,
the fact that they have a goalie who can get hot. They've got
like
great defense.
Before the lyrics get in, so
final 20 seconds. Keneally up top, Savage way off the mark.
Wow.
Schwale now. Waiting for the whistle. And they were waiting for Schwale to get set. Stall warning in effect. Final 10 seconds. Here's the junior. Has it knocked away. Wiedmeyer poked it away. And the third quarter comes to an end. A quarter dominated by Princeton.
Going to break in.
Two
10,
goals by Tucker Shanley,
nine,
one by
eight,
Chris White,
seven,
three in the quarter.
7-3
Princeton
four,
after three.
Three. Dude, sorry, gave it a long card for that promo.
All right.
All right, let's see what we got here talking out. Coming out of here. I will have billboards, closing billboards, score, and then how about we do Ivy League news and notes? How's that?
Sure.
Yeah, all right. Here's our traffic, everybody. Our traffic is billboards, okay? Billboards, score, and then Ivy League news and notes, all right? Billboards, score, Ivy League news and notes. No, save your game summary for when we come back from another break. Here's our traffic coming back. We're going to do billboards, score, and then Ivy League news and notes. You guys need to see that again, or are you good to go?
Just pop that up one more time.
You got it. Stand by. Promo font 2 in, please. There you go, doctor. Hey, do we know you have the internet? Can we get the score of that game? They're playing Yale right now, Cornell is. All right. So 83, font 1, font 2. We're looking to see if we can get the score, because I think Yale is playing Cornell right now. It should be over. Oh, they won 8-7. Great. You can mention that if you want. All right. They won 8-7. They already mentioned that. All right. Under 45 back. All right, folks. No. He's going to mention it verbally. Billboards, score, Ivy League news and notes. 30 back. 30 back, guys.
Stand by, Black. Give me a 15 there.
Wayne knows what we're doing. That's all it's for.
He's got to be cool.
They probably got like
we're in Black.
10, 9, 8 to billboards. 6, 5. Look at him standing in the circle, ready to go.
3, 2, 1. Roll 83 up on tracker.
Old Spice College Lacrosse is brought to you by Old Spice Body Spray.
Five,
smell is power,
four,
and in part by your local Scion dealer.
Go, Anish.
Welcome back to Princeton, New Jersey, on a beautiful St. Patrick's Day. It is Princeton with a 7-3 lead on Penn in the Ivy League opener for both schools. The start of Ivy League play is actually this weekend in Cornell. They were the preseason pick to win the Ivy. Defending champions in the conference want a share of at least the last nine Ivy titles. They're going to have to go forward without Rob Pennell, although they almost beat Virginia, losing in overtime without Pennell.
Pennell's an unbelievably talented player, but Cornell's deep. They're well coached. And then you look at this. 10 of 21 games last year decided by one goal. You look at the scoreboard today. Cornell knocked off Yale 8-7. So it's as congested as ever in this incredibly deep and talented conference.
Yeah, go figure. Cornell takes Virginia to overtime, the defending champs and the number one team in the nation. But then in a dogfight against Yale, that tells you what conference play is all about.
Yeah, I mean, you look at it. They have Dartmouth, Yale, Penn, Princeton, Cornell, Harvard is getting top five recruits year in, year out now. So this conference is only getting better. I think Penn's a team that has an opportunity to really grow as well, given their proximity to the Philadelphia youth and high school lacrosse. Coach Murphy has done a nice job in his first couple of years here. So this is a conference where, you know, they're no longer just get two, three people in the tournament. They have the opportunity to get four or five, maybe up to six.
That was Belinsky firing wide. Three teams right now ranked in the inside lacrosse top 20. Cornell number three, Princeton and Penn 15 and 19 respectively. As Savage works from behind the cage. And now in the goal line extended area. Checked by Myers. Good defense there by Princeton. Fiorito coming out of the net. Penn's got it. Fiorito quickly gets back on the goal, but a penalty coming up.
Well, promo 1A is good now. It's done, because he did mention it. So I would put promo 3 in your back.
So right there was basically a scrap for the ground ball. Fiorito came out of the cage, did a nice job disrupting that pass to X. But at the end of the day, you always have to control your sticks. And you can see right here, not sure who is it gets hit in the head, but Savage, I believe, comes up with a ball.
Yeah,
and you can
Cunningham
see right there, Cunningham
the
with a karate chop to the top of the head. Going to call that every single time.
So extra man opportunity for Penn, 1-for-3 today.
If that doesn't work, barn wipe. And then if that doesn't work, star wipe.
One goal by
it.
Penn, just the second EMO goal allowed by Princeton all season. That's in 13 attempts, and there is the long pole.
And again,
getting a stick on it.
And Penn, just too complacent. There's going to be a trip here. So a wasted opportunity to man up, but they're not moving the ball quickly and sharp.
Well,
the one time they did,
on
they scored a goal and man up.
Yeah.
So it's something you can never throw passes at this level off
you
your back feet.
Blue,
and right there, Princeton does a nice job getting their sticks in the passing lane. As they're clearing Penn fouls, they're now going to be even here for about... Actually, it looks like they're going to be even
if it's a slash,
for.
I'll take blue. If it's a triple,
you know,
take
they're going to have about a two-second man up, it appears. So basically, killer
leader. Essentially, even 2 seconds afterwards.
Yes, blue.
Take another look at the trip. And Dan Savage, little push from behind.
Yeah, right there. If you're riding, you have to be conscious and cognizant of where your feet are in relation to the player running away from you. Because if they clip one another, this isn't pro football where it's not pass interference because it's incidental contact in college lacrosse. They're going to throw the flag every single time.
Grossman from behind the net. Princeton with another goal. That is 5 unanswered, 8-3, Tigers.
Replays here, 83.
And a nice job here on 5-on-5, get the ball to Tommy Schreiber. This is where the vision kind of is demonstrated. You see him find the freshman McDonald, the Canadian who buries his 6th goal of the season. And that's what Canadians are so good at. If you give them their hands free inside, it's money in the bank.
It's the box lacrosse principles?
It's absolutely what it is. They're used
scoring.
To playing
you know
in more confined areas. And so their stick skills are generally better. And right there, Schreiber felt confident we could force it inside, and he buries it with ease.
Second point of the day for Schreiber. McDonald, the lefty. One of the first Canadian players really to ever play lacrosse at Princeton.
know, there's certain programs that have made a living off recruiting Canadians, whether it's Denver. You know, their coaching staff loves getting the Canadians.
Isn't Brody Merrill coaching high school up there?
So Brody Merrill has started. He's the head coach at the Hill Academy, which is basically a smaller school
that has become a powerhouse
in high school lacrosse. They may have 12 seniors every year, and 12 of them are going playing D1 lacrosse someplace. Yeah. They're recruiting the best of the best in Canada to come out and get them ready to playing at the field game, because Canadians used to have a tough time adjusting. It's a different game. The stick and the ball are the same, but the principles and rules are different. So he's doing a phenomenal job coaching those kids up and getting them ready to play the D1 level.
Tend to see a few of them at Georgetown as well, where Merrill played. I think Travis Como was from that school.
Travis Como's from there. I'm sure Brody Merrill kind of ushers in that way as much as he can.
Grossman, as Princeton now has a 5-goal lead. They have been stout defensively.
Right,
have done enough offensively.
Here.
That time a turnover.
Penn has scored in 26 minutes.
26 minutes, Penn has gone without a goal. Strong ride there, no flag.
So much for incidental contact.
Is Penn able to clear? Parrietti from behind the cage.
Incidental contact on that.
Schwale, he's been a big part of Penn's limited offense. A goal and two assists. What does Penn have to do here against Princeton to get some good shots at least?
They're going to have to catch Princeton sleeping in transition opportunities like right here, but they really got to start attacking the short sticks with more urgency. Don't just become a feeder. Try to win your one-on-one matchup against the short stick D-Mitty, whether it's going against Fernandez or you're going against Strabo. You need to win, you need to score. No more of this passive offense.
Adler, bounce shot. Like it went off Fiorito. State Penn ball.
And well, that's a far out shot. That's what they're going to need to do. It clearly hasn't worked, but they've been trying to be patient and find the inside. So you're going to have to start taking more risks and firing shots from less desirable places and just hope your shooters kind of find their range.
Matt, when Penn was down 2 goals, you said that's almost like a 4-goal deficit or a 5-goal deficit. What is a 5-goal deficit for Penn?
I think it's game over. You don't like to say that with 10 minutes left, but Penn just needs to adjust their game plan, and they hope to hope Princeton doesn't play as solid defense as they had throughout the course of the game.
Myers has had a great game. He was on Savage. And now it's Schwale, checked by the All-Ivy League defender, Chad Wiedmeyer.
Yes, you
Wiedmeyer,
can.
Wiedmeyer staying with him, not giving him much room.
And I know Schwale is your quarterback, but Chad Wiedmeyer is one of the best defensive players in the country. You can find a better matchup.
That one looked like it hit the crossbar, then a high shot from double play. Too high.
And that's one of the ones where I was a shooter, I never aimed for corners on that the deflection.
Why?
Because the goalie's out of position. And so you just need to get the ball in cage, because he's not going to have time to get his feet set and find you as a shooter. You just need to get it on cage and don't try to pick the corners as Swale did right there.
Fitzpatrick. Fiorito chased him behind, and that hits the side of the net.
Okay, we're good.
Ground ball scooped up by Princeton goalie Tyler Fiorito, the senior preseason All-American, 10th pick in the Major League Lacrosse draft. Fernandez bullies his way across the midfield line.
Yeah.
He's one of the fastest players on the team, real physical guy.
You can see how athletic he is, and that's generally what you see as defensive midfielders, your best athletes on the field who can get up and down, who are, you know, great hockey players, great football players, great soccer players. Every team needs those, and I think it's...
Grossman has it knocked away.
Bring your promo back.
I think it's a unique coach who can spot and identify those kids.
Feeney out of the goal. Over to Kashansky, and here comes Pett.
This is where Penn needs to capitalize. Princeton's done a nice job getting in the box, but you have to attack in transition.
Zach Lasko, the double team came. He lost it. Princeton recovers.
Score here.
And it's Schreiber back the other way. Schreiber on Kashansky. Pass to the middle. Easy look and a score for the freshman McDonald.
Real time here. Real time. Is that good on Red? From the turnover, guys. Let's go Red here. Red, real time.
And you can see just a nice job by Princeton thwarting UPenn's transition opportunity. White, that's so key. Getting it up the field to your best player in space. And right here, this is the first time Schreiber, in my opinion, has kind of won that one-on matchup. Forces it inside to McDonald, who gets his second in a row, seventh of the season. And this is why they brought him here to Princeton, New Jersey, to finish those type of opportunities.
I was talking with Princeton's play-by-play man before the game, and he said, one thing about this Tigers team, they had a couple of close losses,
to Johns Hopkins in North Carolina. North Carolina, if you watched the game, that was one where Princeton looked like they let it slip away.
No, McDonald's close, Shanley's close, and Ficarro's
recovered by
close.
Penn, so they win at the X there. But he said Princeton played its best
good
game of the
stuff.
Year against Villanova, and in this second half, they have been almost perfect.
Yeah, and you look at that North Carolina game, they lost to a very talented North Carolina team by one goal, and Tyler Fiorito made two saves. You know, that's going to happen once in a, you know, a half, you know, blue moon, that he only has two saves when he sees
right
that
now,
many types of shots. And against Johns Hopkins, you know, Bassett, the goaltender for Johns Hopkins,
maybe the best in the country,
is unbelievable. He made an amazing save that would have tied the game, and then Print, and then Hopkins went down and scored right away and kind of got the momentum. So game, the lacrosse game really is a game of inches.
You know?
And the best teams generally win those inches, but Penn, excuse me, Princeton is right there with their ability.
I mean, if they beat Hopkins, they beat North Carolina. We're talking about a 5-0 team that might be in the top three or four right now.
Oh, absolutely. You hear Coach Bates' voice. He goes, we know we're good. We know we have the ability to be really good. We just need to make those smaller plays a little bit better, and we're going to be a factor down the road.
Keneally gets free, and was saved by Fiorito.
Wow, give me the save back.
Well, Tyler Fiorito came into
back.
This game in a bit of a slump.
Hold
Chris
on, Red,
Bates
right
told
there.
Us he was showing
UVU.
Signs of
UVU
coming out of it.
Save.
Hasn't faced a ton of tough shots, but he's made the plays he's supposed to this game.
And that was a nice job by Keneally stepping up there. But I got to say, that's probably Tyler Fiorito's definitely his best save today, maybe of the season.
Update
and
your
for goalie, it's
points.
Such a mental okay. position. All you need is
that
one
nice
kind of opportunity to regain your confidence. And right there, he is playing. He's not seeing a lot of action, but he's playing like a goalie with confidence. And you can only hope that that builds on one. On
playing
itself.
Like the All-American he is. Paul Carcaterra, our colleague, once told me, you got to be a little crazy to be a lacrosse goalie. Fiorito's a guy who went running with the Bulls
what
in Pamplona,
Spain. What saves does Fiorito have?
While he was there.
Oh, definitely save package on Fiorito.
Spain. I mean, that's is that crazy enough for you?
I mean,
Is that the guy you want in goal? One who's not afraid to run with the Bulls?
The crazier, the better. I don't think I've ever met a normal goaltender. They all have their unique intricacies. And, you know, Tillman Johnson, great goaltender, was an interesting person. Danny McCormick, who I played with in high school before games, would you know, turn the lights off and have disco music going and sit there getting ready for the game. So they're very interesting players.
Himmler with a shot. And now a flag comes up.
Let me see the hit. Ooh, 85. And then...
Let's see what the penalty is here.
Let's let him call the penalty. After he calls it, I'll show you the replay of the hit. It's going to be an 85. Come on, mate.
38. Legal body check to the head. 1 minute, full time. Boom, 3-8. Legal body check to the head. Full time, non-release.
Yeah, that's a non-release. That's something you're cracking down on is hits to the head.
Yeah, and right here it's a tough situation. You get vicious hit to the head. That, I'm surprised, wasn't a 3-minute unreleasable by number 38, Santomo. And for me, look, that's a new rule to the game of lacrosse, this up to the ref's discretion on what's unreleasable and what's not. To me, look, I'd like to take as much out of the ref's hands for giving the discretion like that. They had called 3 minutes there, and this was a tie game. That's a huge call, and they can do it. So fortunately here, that's not the situation, but I'm not sure if I'm a fan of that new, yes, protect the players, but don't give the ref discretion to say what's unreleasable and what isn't.
Look out for number 7 and number 2, Schoenfeld and Shanley. They're the EMO specialists, and there is number 2 for Schoenfeld, third man up
here.
Goal of the season. 6'6", 250 pounds.
Shot
out of New York
will probably be on replays here. 83.
And for Schoenfeld is a key piece, I think, for
Red's
Princeton because
next.
He has that range from the outside. And man up has to stretch the people out, but even.
Red.
Shot they need again. Him to get 100% healthy because, again, if this isn't man up and they're playing zone or the team's
good.
Playing a sloughed man-to-man, people who can shoot from the outside open things up. So that's a good sign for Princeton to get him out there and show that he has range so people are going to have to account for him down the road.
Yeah, people we never heard of
and Schoenfeld, a big part of Princeton's man up. 3 of his 4 goals this season, again, on the EMO.
30 seconds.
Face-off won by Princeton.
Timeout.
Still...
They're down 7,
a little more than 20 seconds left on the man up. Remember, it was a non-releasable penalty.
So they can score again here.
What's impressed you the most about the Tigers today?
I think for me it's been
focus
kind of those
points,
loose ground ball situations and the fact that they've been playing well at faceoffs.
Which one?
I think in order to compete you have to dominate ground balls and
win. Yeah, I'll take that.
At least
30 minutes without
majority of those 50-50 ones. And with their length and with Cunningham, with Myers, with Wiedemeyer, they can do that. That's what Duke's been so great at and why they're always in the big picture of things at the end of spring, because their defensive players are so long and rangy and great in ground balls.
They get Manley back this year, too.
Yeah, and so Princeton is showing that they have those type of players as well. I think that's extremely key and been very, very impressive for them.
These are pop here.
Princeton turned it over at the tail end of the EMO.
32 minutes.
10-3.
Go ahead.
Penn has gone more than 30 minutes without a goal. That's more than a half.
And they really haven't had any opportunities.
Nice.
They haven't had good looks.
They hit the post once. Fiorito made a nice save on Keneally.
Is that it?
Other than that, they haven't even sniffed, and they're making unforced turnovers.
Oh, wait, stand by
and
here.
This is kind of
stand
one of those things
here,
where it's almost like a quicksand where things just start going wrong.
Stop, side out here.
They continue to build on one another and lose your confidence.
Promo 3.
Penn will get it. Went out on Princeton. Don't forget, next Saturday, ESPNU, couple of terrific matchups. Maryland taking on North Carolina, followed at 2 Eastern as Johns Hopkins takes
actually,
on
it's
Virginia.
Penn's, it's Penn's ball
Hopkins,
here.
Virginia.
I'll take Penn's focus points.
Number one potential championship weekend preview, of course.
Thank you.
Coming up next here on ESPNU. Great rivalry in the sport, Syracuse and Johns Hopkins. Very young Syracuse team this year, losing to 7 All-Americans. And
give me that coming up. Give me
John
that
Galloway, I mean, he's... What an all-timer, right?
They lost, you know, staples and cornerstones of that offense a 4-year and on the defensive end. I think this is a big matchup for Syracuse. I know they played Virginia close.
Turnover by Penn.
They played Virginia close, but that game is always close and it's always up and down. I think you're really going to kind of learn more about Syracuse today as they face a team with Johns Hopkins, who probably has a better defense than Virginia. And can their offense compete in those type of games? It'll be interesting to see. But this, to me, more so than that Virginia game, playing Virginia close, is going to be the telling story for the Syracuse team and kind of where they are at.
Princeton focus
at this
points
because point
they're stalling here.
To look ahead to next week, you got Virginia and Johns Hopkins. Right now, those two, I mean, they're 1-2. Virginia 1, Hopkins 2. They look
keep it up,
like the two best teams. That could very well be a matchup that we see toward the end of May. And bad break there for Penn. They're able to recover.
All right, give me from the
Harry Eddy ends the scoring
drought. Here. The whole transition. There we go, right there, 83. Great.
That is their first goal since the second
the whole
quarter.
Transition here.
A drought of more than 33 minutes.
This is my
and just a nice job
here.
Pushing in transition. You can see they push in defense, and right now, nice job drawing and dumping, and then Perry gets the rebound off the goal and is finally able to stick one and end that 30-minute drought. You know, Penn at that point, the coaching staff, you could see it in their face, oh, gosh, another post. But they recoup and make a nice save.
That's actually...
Damn, he won that clean like a mug.
Matt McMahon with the goal against, like Perry Eddy.
Who I think about talking to... I would love. Let's talk. There's so many guys to choose from Princeton.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it was Perry Eddy McMahon. Is
got for Carl.
On defense.
He was one who drew it down the field in transition, made the nice dump off pass, but it was Perry Eddy's alert kind of garbage goal
Let's
instincts that picked it up and kind of had the open net there.
For Carl.
Yeah, Perry Eddy's second of the game, seventh of the
Ten
season.
Ten White.
Less than 3 minutes to play. Here at Clash of 1952 Stadium, Princeton has dominated this second half. It was a 4-3 game at the half. They have scored
say what?
6 goals in the second half. Penn just won. Quakers went more than 30 minutes without a goal. And it's 10-4.
Got it.
Princeton looking to go
rather
to 1-0
have them,
the Ivy.
Going Himmler. To go to break or something.
Checked by McMahon. And open look there. Oh, McDonald, he's got the hat trick.
Actually, now I'm going to take McDonald for the hat trick. We'll go 83, then blue, okay? Replays. 83. Blue is going to be next.
And right here, nice job from Ficarro picking up the ground ball here, making a smart pass to Schreiber. One more McDonald for the hat trick. That's Schreiber's, I believe, third assist to the Canadian, the freshman inside. That's a type of duo you like to see from teams. Virginia Stanwyck
number 26.
To Bocklet. Can it now be Schreiber and McDonald? That's something you can definitely build upon. One's a freshman, one's a sophomore.
Yeah. And Matt, I know you played attack.
And we'll
having
do
a lefty,
package
what does that do
trick.
when you're a feeder like Schreiber or Ficarro?
it opens everything up.
No,
most
I'm sorry,
teams.
McDonald, I'm sorry.
There's
McDonald.
Always that one lefty, it always seems like.
And a lefty needs to be a shooter.
Yes,
he needs to be able to catch and finish and move the ball well.
Sorry,
that's what
that.
McDonald is. Because you generally draw on the one side, you split down the left side, and then you make two passes, you're going to find that lefty wide open. So
white.
It's a crucial piece, and almost all the good teams have that lefty finisher who you can run the offense through. They're generally kind of like the point man in terms of when you draw a slide, bing, bang, you're going to have that person wide open on the left side, and you need them to bury the ball well.
Now, when you're a lefty, too, doesn't that create some more natural angles, too?
It, depending on the side of the field, absolutely. You know, sitting there in advance, you're so effective shooting the ball. But, again, you want that lefty to be able to capitalize on your other players drawing the attention to themselves.
Yep.
Parrietti
up,
has his
button.
Shot go off the top of the goal. Top crossbar.
Just a quick mention coming up next.
Just missing the hat trick. Coming up next, Syracuse, number 5 of the nation, taking on Johns Hopkins, the second-ranked team.
Be sure
50th
to
meeting all time.
To work on. Focus points.
They've combined for
end
what?
Of game stats.
80 national championships.
Definitely the two dominant programs in the history of our sport.
Game summer.
Other people aspire
you know,
to beat your Syracuse and Johns Hopkins programs. Some people making inroads, but in terms of the longevity of our sport, they're the most consistent names who are always there.
Princeton looking to get back to that level. They were there not too long ago. Great run under Bill Tierney. As Parrietti's shot goes wide and high. And then last year, I think people focus on the four wins.
How are they with an advancer?
But, man, I mean, you talk about just getting ravaged by injuries. 15 players hurt last year, 5 season-ending injuries.
How are they with an advancer?
Rob Costello's played well today, one of their better defensemen. He was out for the year. Quick stick, not there for Penn. Fitzpatrick is there.
And that's one of those things as a coach, there's nothing you can do. It's just kind of the way things unfold. You can adjust accordingly, but you can only have so much depth in your team. And like you said, Princeton last year, everything that could go wrong injury-wise did go wrong.
Here's what we're going to do.
This game ball, it's going to be scooped up.
And then we go to break.
By nobody. It goes out of bounds.
Then we come back from break. We'll look
and
to do
it'll
an
be Penn ball.
We'll do an
with
interview.
Less than a minute
we'll
to play here
break.
In the fourth
and
quarter. Princeton
second break, they can
seems to have this one. They've got
that.
An 11-4 lead. This is the first of three consecutive Ivy League games for Princeton on the road at Yale and Brown for their next two. And then they're at Syracuse, which will be an interesting matchup because this is a more experienced Princeton team against a young Syracuse team, but by then you never know.
Yes. End of the game here. I'll let you guys do a comment. You can milk it a little bit, and then I'll give you. Then I'll give you a. Then I'll count you the break. And we're going to try to get McDonald for an interview. That's our traffic so far.
Penn gets it on the foul, and we'll just run out the clock here. Final 10 seconds. Princeton, mighty impressive in
this
second
one.
Half. It was
they're
a 4-3 game at halftime. Princeton outscores Penn 7-1 over the final 30 minutes. They held Penn scoreless for more than a 30-minute stretch. On offense, on defense, really a complete effort by Chris Baines and the Tigers.
If Princeton can shoot the way they did in the second half, they're going to be very difficult out for anyone. They have the athletes. They have the skill on offense. And if they can shoot efficiently in that 35% as a team, they're very dangerous.
Fourth win of the season for Princeton. It matches the team's win total from a year ago. Penn falls to 1-4 on the season, and it's Princeton getting off to a good start in conference play by winning its Ivy League opener. We're back after this.
All right, let's see if we can get McDonald. We'll have McDonald's package. Okay. All right. If we don't get them, we'll just talk. You know, we'll just talk McDonald. All right. So here's our traffic coming back. Score. Score. We'll try to get McDonald here on headsets. If he's not on headsets, we'll just do his package. Okay. Do you have that game summary graphic ready? Game summary. Can you have it ready for me? The show.
Thank you.
Okay. It's on the 40. I don't think we're gonna get him here. I don't think we're going to get him. So what we'll do is score, McDonald package, and then a game summary graphic, okay? And then we'll take another break, all right? But 20
soon
back.
We got to get it to 4, right?
Yes, indeed.
15.
So take your time with it and have fun with it. We're not going to have him for an interview. So score, McDonald package game summary, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and go, Anish.
Welcome back to Princeton, New
Stand by
Jersey,
red here.
The Tigers prevail against Penn in the Ivy League opener for both teams. 11-4, the final
Patrick.
Score.
Red.
Matt Ward and Ish Schroff.
Support
it
music.
Was the freshman, Mike McDonald, 3 second-half goals.
Okay.
He gets the hat trick, the
game
best game of his young career. And he was a big part of a really team effort in the second half for Princeton.
Yeah, he's out there to finish the ball. And Princeton did a nice job moving it along, and he capitalized on his opportunities. And he's someone to watch.
One question
season.
About the game.
Penn, their offense went into hibernation
right,
over the last
this,
37
we're take another
minutes.
Break,
one
okay.
goal, but you got to credit the Princeton defense. They really didn't allow a lot of
we're
good looks
another
in this
break
game.
After
yeah,
his
Princeton
here.
Locked down today. You had Chad Wiedmeyer, always considered one of the best in the country. You have Myers. You have
he's
John Cunningham in the middle of the field. Their D-middies, Fernandez and Strabo, were very good. Chris White, the D-middie, did a nice job. If they play solid defense and get their big guns, Jeff Ricardo
count to break after his comments.
And Schreiber going,